We actually left off in the middle of Lazarus being raised from the dead last week. So if you would turn to John 11. I'm going to do a very quick reading. Now, I say very quick. I'm actually going to start at the first verse of chapter 11 and start reading there. Now, we already covered that, so we're not going to spend a lot of time on that. But I do, because we left off in the middle, I want to just start there. So I'm going to read very quickly chapter 11 out of John, starting at the first verse. Now, a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister Lazarus. When he had heard therefore that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the place where he was. And we discussed that at length. Then after that saith he to his disciples, Let us go into Judea again. His disciples say unto him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and goest thou thither again? Jesus answered, Are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. These things said he, and after that he saith unto them, Our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of the sleep. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking of rest and sleep. Then Jesus said unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent that ye may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, Let us also go, that we may die with him. There's the Eeyore of your disciples. Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off, and when many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she had heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask God, God will give it to thee. Jesus saith unto her, Thy brother shall rise again. And Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She saith unto him, Yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. And when she had so said, she went her way and called Mary her sister secretly, saying, The Master is come and calleth for thee. As soon as she had heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where Martha met him. The Jews which were in her house and comforted her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out following her, saying, She goeth to the grave to weep there. Then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled, and said, Where have ye laid him? And they said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept, and we discussed that a little bit at length last week too. Then said the Jews, Behold, how he loved him. Some of them said, Could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man should not have died? Jesus therefore, again groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. It was a cave and a stone laid upon it. And Jesus answered, said, Take ye away the stone. We kind of stopped a couple few verses ahead of this last week. But a thought that I had with that, the Jesus said, Take ye away the stone, said, Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he had been dead 4 days. And I think we may have touched on that a little bit last week, but something that has that I really like to reiterate is how that this can be such an analogy to where we are today. Sometimes when we have not, when we have lived in a situation so long, when we've lived in a situation that seems that there is no hope. It's dead. This morning we were talking on the way to church about the saying, beating a dead horse to death. In the spiritual realm, beating a dead horse is the same thing as giving up. And it's, you know, now I understand the pros and cons of that saying. You know, beating a dead horse to death is a, you know, what does it say, insanity. The definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over again, expecting different results. Yes. That's in the flesh. In the spirit, the effectual fervent. If you're from Kentucky or Tennessee, it's fervent. If you're, you know, in, you know, if you say it in North properly, it's fervent. And that is the fevered pitch. I almost can see that as a, not a frenzy, but a desperate. And I think sometimes the situations in our life, our Lazaruses, it might be our brother, our husband, our wife, our child, our parent, our coworker, our cousin, our niece, whoever, our best friend, may not be a believer, or they may be sick, or they may be this. And to us, the situation seems dead with no hope, to the point where it may even stink. How many times have we heard Marcy and Angie and Mandy testify about the situation with their sister, how that she was so dead in her addiction that it stunk, that she wasn't even allowed in their homes anymore? And I'm not telling anything that this is her testimony. I'm not telling anything personal. That she wasn't even allowed in their homes because she was stealing from them to feed her addiction. And how she seemed, there was times where months at a time they didn't even know she was alive or dead. They didn't know where she was. And she was actually found face down in a ditch, homeless, given up for dead. And I think, didn't she just celebrate 5 years saved, yes, and sober, amen, and straight?
Amen. Yes, ma'am.
Also, Mandy's brother, same thing happened to him too.
Yeah. Exactly. And so, in that situation, I remember Mandy and Ken had just started coming here, and Mandy sat over in our living room over here when we still lived here, and she said to us, I'm in such a struggle because it's my sister. I don't want to tell her she cannot live in my house, but I have children, and I cannot have her stealing from me, and I tried to help her before, and I've got to say no this time. And you know, Mandy, she's one of the sisters I call Grace. They're between Mandy, Angie, and Josie, I call Mercy, Grace, and something else. And she said, and we finally told her, if you don't, and the whole thing was, if we tell her no, what if she dies out there? Well, if you keep giving her ways to feed her addiction and not seeking help, she's going to die anyway. Mm-hmm. You know, and so that situation seemed dead and hopeless, and it stunk. And I think that we live in those situations. And so when the Lord says to us, now we've got a whole chapter here where one sat still and waited on Jesus, where one ran to get him and sent for him, two sisters, two different personalities, both of them calling out to him in the way they knew how, serving him in the way they knew how, needing him to fix this dead situation in their lives. And then we get to this pivotal moment where now the rubber meets the road. Here we are. Now, they both know their brother is dead, and that it is hopeless, and that it stinks, and there's a big old stone in front of the cave, and why are we resurrecting dead things? But that's in their flesh. And you can see the whole flesh spirit war that's going on with both these sisters here, because Mary sat still because she knew Jesus was coming. Martha ran out to get him. And when he says, do this, he only sleepeth, they both start questioning him, but he stinketh, but he's dead. So you see that they in their spirit, they cried out to Jesus because they knew he was the answer, but in the flesh, through the circumstances, they questioned him. So that ought to give you a little bit of peace of, no, I don't know if peace is the right word. That might ought to give you a little bit of comfort of that you are just like every other person that has ever served him since the beginning of time. And the fact that he knows that about us and loves us anyway. And Paul even preached on the war between the flesh and the spirit. I don't do Black Friday shopping because the flesh is weak. And so I let Betty talk me into going to the mall from 6 to 10. We ended up till midnight, but 6 to 10. And it wasn't bad. Wasn't bad. But standing in line at Macy's, three people in front of me. By the time that we got to the third person and just the situation that was going on, I looked at Melissa Hollis. I said, some people just need to be hit with a ball bat. And as soon as I said it, I thought, okay, it's time for Shelly to go home because the flesh is winning. Paul said, the things that I would do, which would be to stand there patiently. I'm just gonna hang myself for you guys. Mind you, I had just written an entry for our Heaven Saints newsletter. For those of you that do not know, I'm the international leader of the Heaven Saints Motorcycle Ministry Ladies Ministry. We have a newsletter that comes out quarterly. I had just written an entry under my little section of the newsletter about entering this season of Thanksgiving, and also its arch rival, greed. And how that we needed to try to live a complaint-free life. And I had mentioned, for example, when you are standing in line and there is a holdup in the line, instead of sighing and puffing and whatever, however I wrote it, think of it as maybe an opportunity that God has given you to make the line last a little longer so that you can witness to the person in front of you or behind you. Yeah, well, that didn't happen to me at Macy's. You know, it didn't. And you, it, now, just after I, so you know what? I failed the test. Okay?
That time.
Because I'm really standing, that time, I'm standing in line and I'm thinking, he has told you the coupon does not apply. He has said it three or four different ways. No app on your smartphone will make you smart. Well, what about this one? Okay, what about this one? Well, here's a read, tell me not. How about this one? We will not accept. Okay. I know what Paul meant when he said those things that I would do, which is stand in line and witness to the lady that obviously needed some Jesus. It said, Paul said, the things that I would do, I don't do. I would have liked to have stood there patiently and been able to say, I just wrote a paragraph in the newsletter. I come across shining. I did it. I conquered. But he also said, the things that I wouldn't do, I do do. And do do is an operative word for it. So what I wouldn't do, what I don't want to do, is lose my patience, lose my temper, not use an opportunity, to waste an opportunity. And I did. And so we see that in Mary and Martha here. The whole war versus the spirit versus the flesh. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. We want to be Jesus pleasers. We want to be Jesus servers. We want to shine amongst all those people that we are witnessing to. And we're supposed to. I don't know if Shiloh had shared something on Facebook, and I shared it too. And it's so true, but you talk about, I think Rachel put spank, and it was. It has a picture of Santa Claus, and he's dropping his glasses down, kind of winking, and it says, put the Christ back in Christmas. How about putting the Christ back in Christians?
Yeah, I remember that.
Oh, yeah. Because we will all say Merry Christmas when they say Happy Holidays to us, because it bristles us. And I'm going to be at Macy's when they say Happy Holidays to me. I'm going to say Merry Christmas back to them. Absolutely. I'm not going to write Xmas on my front window.
No.
I'm not Xing Jesus out of Christmas.
No way.
But I'm going to hit the lady in Macy's with a ball bat.
Right.
did not do it. But I thunk it. Jesus said, if you think, you know, I should have went ahead and done it. Jesus said, if you think it, you already did it. You already did it. Teasing, teasing. And so we see this going on with Mary and Martha. They believe that Jesus is the answer. They believe that they're going to be comforted. They believe they're going to receive peace. They believe these things. But yet, Lord, here are the circumstances. I believe you are the Christ. I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you can fix my marriage. I believe you can fix my lost children. I believe you can fix this health situation. I believe you can fix this, what has been spoken death over. But Lord, the doctor says, but Lord, she says, but Lord, I haven't seen my child in 6 months. I don't even know if they're alive or dead. But Scott preached a message one time and he said, but God. We go, but God, the doctor says, but God, he says he doesn't love me anymore. But God, I don't know where my child is. But God, I know what my paycheck is, and I know what my electric bill is. But God, and the word says, but God. But God. You know, Brother Jackson, those of you that remember him, Kelvin Jackson, love, love, love them. Mm-hmm. He used to sing a song when Jesus, when he was 4 days late, he was right on time. And this is the song. Jesus said, take ye away the stone, verse 39. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, saith unto him, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he have been dead 4 days. Now, if any of you have any knowledge, and those of you, you know, it used to be maybe somebody had medical knowledge, now we watch so much CSI and Criminal Minds and stuff, we are all forensic specialists. You know that, and I don't mean to be gross or nasty like that, but decomposition starts right away. I watched a Forensic Files or something last night, and this did fascinate me. I didn't know this. The flies that lay the larva, you know, just, hey, did you watch it too?
No, I watched something else about the flies.
Okay, within two hours of death, flies can smell decomposition miles away. 4 days dead in the desert, hot, in a cave that's been no embalming. Jesus said unto her, said I not unto thee, didn't I tell you that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. Now, back in verse 34, he says, and said, where have ye laid him? I've had that burning, I almost, a couple Sundays ago when I shared, when Scott was out of town, I almost shared this message that the Lord has been laying on my heart, where have you laid him? And I knew that this was coming up for Sunday school, and where have you laid him? Where have you laid your spouse? Where have you laid your son? Where have you laid your parent? Where have you laid your marriage? Where have you laid your finances? Where have you laid your health? Just, I can't, where have you laid it? And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I love this verse. And I knew that thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. So even when we have put aside or laid down our situations that we thought were dead, that we thought were hopeless, that we gave up faith, that we lost our faith, that we walked away from our faith in a situation, Jesus still shows up and will still cry out to the God in our stead so that we may believe that he was sent for us. And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. I was ministering to a lady whose son is estranged from the family, who isn't saved, who has turned his back on everything he was taught. And I said to her every single morning, when she said, I pray for him every morning. I said, every morning when you get up, I want you to stand up. His name is Brian. I said, I want you to stand up in the morning, and I said, I want you to say, Brian, come forth. Brian, come forth. Say it every morning. Brian, come forth. And I said, Jesus will show up. And Jesus will, like we talked about with the zombie apocalypse, the walking dead will come into life, will be resurrected. He is the resurrection and the life. In him only is that found. I told her every morning, Brian, come forth. And I said, and I don't care how many years it takes. Years. 4 days in the grave, he was dead. It doesn't matter. And he that was dead, verse 44, and he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. And Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go. And I remember Scott preached an awesome message on this years and years and years ago. And I have shared it many, many times since then. Jesus resurrected him. Who unbound him? Those standing around. Jesus is the resurrection. We are those that help them become unbound from what they used to be gripped with. Not that Jesus doesn't. Don't misunderstand me. We are Jesus to them. We're supposed to be. That was the whole premise of Christ in Christmas. Let's put the Christ back in Christians. What was the old song? Why we are the hands, why aren't we reaching? Jesus said unto them, loose him and let him go. Are we, once Jesus saves? My biggest problem, I'll be honest with you, my biggest issue with, I don't know if I want to say the church, I don't want to be disparaging to the church or anything, but like with our youth camps and with our Sunday school programs, and I'm not just saying our church, any church organization, evangelical, our churches, we spend so much effort and we concentrate so much effort on getting them saved. And as soon as they get saved, we're like, whoop, whoop, on to the next one. And we have no discipleship. And I watch it year after year after year in our youth camps. Kids will come from homes that are just wretched. They'll come from church homes unsaved. They'll come from the street unsaved. And they'll come to camp and they'll get a taste of something they've never experienced before. And we all whoop, whoop, and shout and testify and glorify and praise. And we just get our little shout on and we have a good time at camp and we talk about how good God is. And then 10 o'clock, the last day of camp, mamas are picking up their kids. We're making sure our dorms are clean. And I wonder how many of those kids are contacted when they leave. And so we've all, at camp, the last several years, the people I've worked with, we've really tried to make an effort to get those kids. Nowadays, Facebook, anybody that's ever worked camp, every time you leave camp, you end up with like 100 more friends on Facebook.
Yeah.
That's discipleship. It doesn't matter what the kid thinks it is. Mm-hmm. Kid thinks they just added some people on Facebook. Take the opportunity to make it about discipleship. Take it about the opportunity to unloose them and let them go. Because those ones that came in from those church homes, they came in unsaved at 17. So if they're going back to the same home, now that's not saying that every church home, now listen, there's a difference between a church home and a Christian home.
That's right.
They came in that way for a reason. They're going back to the same thing. So when your co-workers come, when we see new people come, Madison, let's get her name and number. Hey, enjoyed having you, Sunday. Now, we don't want 40 of us call her the same week. That's not what I'm saying. There's a difference between loose him and let him go and smother him and kill him again. It's something we need to think about. Loose him and let him go. That's our job. To peel those. You know what? And we all have different stories. We all have different stories. So when a person comes in and he is resurrected and he receives new life, I might be able to pull off that one piece of gauze that might be on condemnation. I'm a terrible mother because I yelled at my kids. You might be able to peel off, oh, that'd probably be the same one for you.
Yeah.
You might be able to peel off, you might be able to peel off that I was an alcoholic and I am no more. You might be able to, of course, I'm throwing stuff out there. I'm not giving anybody a story out, but you might peel off a, I was addicted to prescription pills. You might pull off a, I was an adulteress. You might be able to pull off, I'm depressed. I can't get out of bed. You might be able to pull off, I never felt loved growing up. I never had parents that loved me. All the layers that covered that person in death. Every one of us might have the ability, the testimony, the witness, the strength, and the love, and the understanding to pull off that one layer. Verse 45, then many of the Jews which came to Mary and had seen the things which Jesus did believed on him. We've only got about 5 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes left. We're going to go into the next. We've only got 4 miracles left to study in this series. This one, if you will go to John 18. I'm sorry. No. Luke 18. Luke 18, starting at the 35th verse. This is a story that if you grew up in church at all, you know. Verse 35 in Luke 18. And it came to pass that he was come nigh to Jericho, a certain man sat by the wayside begging. And hearing the multitude pass by, he asked what it meant. You know, he heard the noise start. And they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passeth by. Now, we're getting to the end. If you actually read the scriptures up above this, because remember, we tried to do these somewhat in chronological order the best we could. The scriptures above these, they're already talking about, you know, the heat is getting very, you know, it's getting hot around there. It's getting very tense. We're getting close to the crucifixion. He has worn out his welcome with those that sought to kill him. It's getting tough. All right, so now when you hear the noise of Jesus of Nazareth, you have a couple different noise factors going on. You have those that were seeking after him to receive from him, and those that were seeking after him to take him out, to be done with him, because they thought he was going to take from them. Okay? And that was the whole political thing of the time, that he was coming saying he was the king, and they started politically feeling very threatened because they didn't understand. Okay. Or the kingship and the kingdom. So and he cried saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And they which went before him rebuked him that he should hold his peace. But he cried so much the more, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And I love this area of scripture because couple different things going on there. He was just some old blind beggar. He needed to hush up. Jesus didn't have time for him. That's what they're telling him. Hush. Kind of like they did when the little the little children thronged him and the disciples basically said, shh. He doesn't have time for your nonsense. You're children. You're noisy. You make messes. You spill things. You step on his feet. You pull at his robe. You tug at him. My grandbabies were at my house all day yesterday. I get it. I get it. You know, they first come in the door. They first come in the door, and I'm like, oh, my entire life just walked in my door. By the time the day was up, I'm like, woo, I need a break from life. And Jesus rebuked the disciples and said, you don't get it. These noisy, messy, mess ups, tripping over their own feet, spilling things, breaking things, tearing things up, raising the roof, is what it's all about. Amen. And they told him to hold his peace, but I love this. But he cried so much the more, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Listen to me, people. Politically, we live in a world where they're telling you to hush. Cry even louder. Cry even louder. Because we desperately need Christ. Forget back in Christmas. We need Christ back in us. We need to be not a nation, but a world that understands Christ, who Christ is. You know, we struggle with the Muslims, don't we? And I think, I'm a little bit more worried about the Christians who don't know who he is. Or the people that claim to, the church folk. The ones who we live under a don't judge me, you can't judge me, I'm under grace. And I'm afraid that grace is of none effect. That's scripture. You've made grace of no effect. Because we want to mold Jesus into our concept of how we can have him and the world too. But we live in a world where we who believe, we who know we are wretched man, and that we struggle every Black Friday at Macy's. Lord, I don't want to be that person. Make me different. And if that means I can't be there yet because I'm not smart enough, I'm staying home next year. Lord, help me. I failed the very thing that I admonished others to do. Help me, Lord. So we've got to cry out, you know, hold your peace. You messed up. Don't you ever write another newspaper article again. Because that's what the enemy will say. And I say, and hush up. Because I messed up, I more now have to get to him, even more so than before. But we, as Christians, are living in a nation where you are under fire. Your belief. Now we tolerate every belief there is but Christianity. We tolerate, we give room for every club except. You know, now they're doing the whole transgender bathroom thing.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Kentucky just passed it. They told the Kentucky schools they had to build transgender bathrooms. Kentucky schools said, we don't have the money for that. So therefore, they've said that any student that feels like that they can use any bathroom that they want to use, will ever 17-year-old boy just turn gay.
Yeah, right.
And you know what? Where's my right? Where's my right that my daughter can go into a bathroom without boys?
Oh my.
Where's my right? No, because that's intolerant. So the more they try to hush you up and tell you that you need to hold your peace about who is the Son of David, the Christ, you get even louder. You get even louder. I heard somebody say, Jenna, you'll appreciate this. Somebody sent me a Facebook card. And, of course, you know, because somebody kept saying, you know, because they put our videos on YouTube now. And, you know, I'm a concealed carry permit owner and all this. They said, you know, you're probably on a government list somewhere. I said, oh, I'm probably on one or two. And I said, but if you're not on a government list, you ought to be ashamed. If you're not on a government list somewhere, you ought to be ashamed. If we are on a government list because we believe in Christ and preach Christ and preach against a world that preaches against Christ, rise up, shout it out, cry it out. Verse 40, and Jesus stood and commanded them to be brought unto him, and when he was come near, he asked him, saying, what wilt thou that I shall do unto thee? And he said, Lord, that I may receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, receive thy sight, thy faith hath saved thee. And immediately he received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise unto God.
Amen.
So we're gonna stop there, get ready for our 11 o'clock service.